Sir, with your permission, may I start? Professor M.M. Sharma, Professor G.D. Yadav, and all my dear friends here, I am here today to speak on a topic which most of you are most likely to find very unusual, but there's an assurance from my side that I'll tell you some very interesting stories, stories which you are most likely to not have heard of. To begin with, though I said bye-bye to chemical engineering in 1994, I do still remember a smattering of it. Professor G.D. Yadav taught me multiphase reactors, and I still recall regime 3 and Hatta number, which is under root DAK to B0 upon KL. So that is because my M.Tech project, which was based on design of a packed column for the absorption of NOx, it was a very theoretical exercise. I, very surprisingly for a UDCTN, was very greatly inclined to mathematics and mathematical modeling in my final year, and I got this opportunity at IIT Delhi to upgrade the mathematical model proposed by Professor Joshi and Suchak, which was about NOx absorption in a packed column. It was a mathematical exercise because I never stepped into any laboratory, did a bit of research, and we were successful in upgrading the model and getting it published in Computers in Chemical Engineering then, which was a fairly tall order. And I still do remember a smattering of the subject, I must confess it here. But that's not why I'm here today. The topic for today's discussion and presentation is entitled Behind the Raised Walls. As the Inspector General of Police, no prizes for guessing that these raised walls are the walls of the prisons. And next slide, please. But I would not confine myself only to the physical walls of the prisons, but also I would like to dwell upon certain stereotypes, in particular the frozen mindset of the British Indian government. It was a colony then, in their colonial jail policy. I'll try to make it as interesting as possible. Next. Now, before we move on to the main subject, a quick browsing through history is essential so as to... Sir, I think I'm overdressed, so I can get rid of... Sir, right, sir. Now, what happened is, historically, in the year 1600, the British stepped onto Indian soil to trade here with India, and it was basically a company called the British India, East India Company, that had come here with the object of trading. So they went on trading, but they also began dabbling in Indian politics. Those were the days when there were rulers and princely states, so on and so forth. And a very important battle was fought in the year 1757, not very far from Bengal, called the Battle of Plassey. This was fought between the British forces led by Robert Clive and Siraj ud Dawla, who was the Nawab of Bengal then, and the British one, the company one rather. Close on the heels came the next battle called the Battle of Buxar, which was fought once again between the British forces and Mir Qasim, who was now the Nawab of Bengal, and here too the British won. And then this was a major, it was a watershed, a major milestone in the history of India, because Bihar, Bengal and Orissa passed into the hands of the British. And these are some of the photographs there. And the British established their rule there, and then they slowly made attempts to spread over India and extend their rule all over. Now, while all of this was happening, while the British were trading and expanding, so on and so forth, by British I mean the company here, it was the company Raj essentially, they faced a couple of problems which I think it would be in the fitness of things for me to narrate. The very first one was that the company had to deal with two major law and order issues. The very first one was the Pindari Menace. Now what had happened is, I'll tell you who the Pindaris were. The Pindaris essentially were an irregular army, mercenaries basically. See, what would initially they were the Mughal rulers, and subsequently they tagged themselves along with the Maratha army. Now, what would essentially happen, I'll just give an example, is see, whenever the Peshwa forces would leave Pune for a military excursion to say north, maybe Punjab, so on and so forth, their strength initially would be say close to 20,000-30,000. But by the time they would reach Punjab, it would swell to 1,80,000, a figure of this sort. Now, how did it swell? What would happen is, en route, there used to be these irregular Pindaris who would join them and swell their ranks. Now, the object of these Pindaris was to pillage. They were just not interested in any military conquest. They were not having any ideological basis. They would join the army, and en route, they would pillage the villages and, you know, pick up their booty, and that is what they would do often. Now, with the collapse of the Muslim rulers and the Maratha Empire, they were practically quote unquote jobless with very little to do, and so they did what they were having no option. They took to plundering the countryside, and this turned out to be a very major problem which the company had to deal with. Now, the strength of the Pindaris was supposedly close to 30,000 to 40,000. So it was in the year 1817 that the company engaged the Pindaris with a force of close to 1,20,000 in Bengal, Deccan and Gujarat. It's called the Pindari War of 1817, and the Pindaris were practically annihilated in the war, and the menace was brought under control. But then very soon a different kind of law and order issue they had to deal with. This was called the thagi, or the menace of the thugs. Thug, that's what it was called then. Now, the thugs were basically highway robbers. They would unobtrusively intermingle with travelers and then murder them and loot them. They have also been referred to as Funshigars, that is what they were called, because they would always carry something like a noose or a scarf or some such thing, and they would invariably strangulate the victim to death, loot them, and this had become a major problem all over, which the company had to deal with. And if some of you, I mean, I don't watch movies much, I hardly watch movies, but there was this movie recently called Thugs of Hindustan, which was not a very successful movie, but this was the central idea. What the producer director tried to portray is that some thugs, they come together and try to fight the company, so on and so forth. Now, there's this very interesting book called Confessions of a Thug, written by Philip Meadow Taylor, which is a bestseller. So, if possibly those who are interested might like to go through it. Next one. Now, in order to contain this thuggy menace, The company established what was then called in 1835 the Thuggy and Dacoity Department, which subsequently was rechristened years later as the CID, or the Criminal Investigation Department. Now, Sleeman was essentially an army man. He was a colonel, and then he was made to head the department, and the thugs were close to 4,000 to 5,000 spread all over the country, and then very systematically he went around doing his job, and by 1850 he was fairly successful in containing the thugs, and there are some very interesting stories about how the last of their leaders, he was chased, and he rode into a forest only to be eaten by a tiger. Now, this was also the time when the British felt the need or the desire to establish holding places, because so many people were being arrested, some were being killed. So this was when the need for the creation of a holding place to hold these criminals was felt, and it was in the year 1836 that a committee came into existence, and this was of which Macaulay, the famous, or you may call him the infamous Lord Macaulay, was a member. And then this was when prisons were set up all over the country, and including Maharashtra and elsewhere, and the object was to be one, to hold them and also have extramural employment, meaning make them work within the prisons. But while all of this was happening, the thugs had come under control and the prisons were being set up. The British introduced a concept, a very, very revolting kind of a concept. A concept, just next one, which was unheard of before that. The British began branding let me restructure it this way. The British introduced the concept of criminals by birth or hereditary criminals. So what they essentially said is that if a person happens to be born in a certain, for example, those days the Pardhis were classified as a criminal tribe. So were the Bills. So what the British, the company essentially said is that if you happen to be born here, then you lose your rights, irrespective of whether you have shown criminal tendencies or not. And they resorted to a variety of measures then, like interning these people, then forcing them to have compulsory registration. So you have to register yourself saying that I belong to this particular tribe, and this particular tribe has been sort of notified as a criminal tribe, and then notify yourself. You had to also give attendance in. They had to give attendance in police stations, so on and so forth. So this was one concept, and the logic that was advanced is this is how India is. Indians have traditional callings. What the father does, the son has to do, so on and so forth. And so some of the logics that they advanced them, and they also introduced this concept of modus operandi of a crime. That to give a very simple, basic, elementary example is, if somebody does a crime in a particular way, then he has to be a Pardhi. So round up all the Pardhis of the area and put them behind bars. Next one. Now, 1857, as we all know, was a turning point in the history of India, because that was when the first war of independence was fought. The British preferred to call it the rebellion or the revolt. And this is when the British government decided to withdraw the company and take powers into their own hands. So this was when, the 1857 is important because this is when the Parliament of England got jurisdiction over the entire nation, and the company had nothing to do thereafter. And this was the period when the British made laws very extensively. And the most important of these laws were, one is the Indian Penal Code, which was enacted in 1860. In 1871, the British passed the Criminal Tribes Act, in which this very concept that had been introduced during the thuggee problem was codified. So this law existed till 1947, after which it was repealed. The next one was the Prisons Act of 1894, and how the prisons department has to be structured in the province, and it was essentially to be headed by an officer styled the Inspector General of Prisons, who would have supervisory and all controls over the jails in the province. And finally, the Code of Criminal Procedure in 1898. Okay, that's all right. Now, what was the British approach to prison administration? The British did not believe in reforms, and their approach attitude was essentially penal. If a man has committed a crime, he should be punished. And there were certain punishments which we immediately repealed after independence. One such punishment is transportation. Transportation meaning a hardened criminal, if convicted, should be taken across the seas and put in a prison somewhere. So he won't be imprisoned in his own country. And if those of them who would like to visit Thane jail, I'll show you the photograph there. Thane jail is right beside a creek. So when Veer Savarkar was sent to cellular jail in Andaman, this is the Andaman cellular jail. So the prisoner would be brought there. And there would be a boat there, or ship, a boat rather. They would be put in that boat, then taken somewhere else, and then transported there to Andamans. So transportation is a punishment which is no longer on statute books. Now, solitary confinement. Now, this is a very horrific kind of a punishment. Solitary confinement essentially means that the prisoner is put in a cell from where he can neither see anyone nor hear anyone. All these cells in the Andaman, Andaman prison, they are all solitary cells. And that was also called then Kalapani ki Saza. You must have, I don't know, heard of it. So that is Kalapani, that's where. Now, penal servitude. This essentially means making the prisoner, assigning the prisoner very difficult physical tasks. Now, once again, we'll be surprised to know that those were the days where prisoners were taken to perform all kinds of menial tasks. Especially, government, they were deployed at PWD sites, such as, for example, construction of government buildings. Most of these huge government British buildings which we see around, they have actually been constructed with prison labor. The laying of railways, prison labor. Road building, road construction, prison labor. Quarry activity, prison labor. So we never realize this, but most of these very imposing structures we see all over, it is nothing but an outcome of prison labor. Next one. The British also had this concept of judicial whipping. Judicial whipping as in prisoners were whipped. Now if you look to the left, the prisoner actually being whipped, and this is called the ghoda, whipping ghoda, where the prisoner is actually mounted and whipped under orders of the courts. Next. Now this is very interesting. These are fetters. The prisoner was fettered. And if you look at the manner in which he is fettered, there are clamps near his ankles, and then there are chains, and this circular ring he has to hold throughout. Now once he came to jail, he was fettered, and those fetters were never removed. He would sleep with those fetters, morning ablutions with these fetters, and the fetters were only removed when he was taken to the court, maybe 100 meters from there. So these were the fetters, very, very, very draconian, very ghastly. Next. Now moving on, talking about Maharashtra. Maharashtra, currently there are 60 jails at 45 locations with some very interesting jails about which I'll be talking about. Now during the British era, these were used for holding criminals, not just criminals, but also revolutionaries and freedom fighters. Now, freedom fighters were generally kept in cells, not barracks. Now, I'll show you some of the prisons here. Now, this is the legendary Yerawada prison, a huge prison. It was once upon a time. I think it still today is the biggest prison in Asia. It can hold close to 5,000 prisoners. Most of our freedom fighters have been there at some point in time or the other. Mahatma Gandhi was there thrice. And there is a, it's now, it has a monumental status now, the place where he used to be kept. There is also, Lokmanya Tilak was also incarcerated there. So was Motilal Nehru, next. And Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, Pandit Nehru, Sarojini Naidu, Subhash Chandra Bose, they are all seen the inside of Yerawada jail. Next one. The Pune Pact was also signed there in Yerawada jail in 1932. Now this is Thane Central Jail. If you look to the left corner, you'll see a part of that creek. You'll see some water there. So that is the point from where the prisoner was taken in case he was awarded transportation for life. And now this is also the jail. Thane Central Jail is also the prison where some of those legendary figures were hanged. Three of whom happened to be Kanhere, Karve and Deshpande. These names must be familiar. Now the Kanhere, Karve and Deshpande had shot dead Nasik collector Jackson. And it is here that they were hung. Next, Vasudev Balwant Phadke gela ka magega. Now Vasudev Balwant Phadke was, he was a revolutionary, and he was, the British transported him to a place, to Aden in Yemen. Next one. This is the Ahmednagar Fort. Ahmednagar Fort is no longer a jail now, but it was used as a jail, particularly in the 1940s, to hold some of our freedom fighters. And this is where Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru wrote the legendary Discovery of India. Next. Now this is one. This is a jail which is very dear to my heart. I think I must dwell on this rather extensively. This is a story. I'm going to tell you a story, a very interesting one. Now Aund is a princely state of Satara. Now princely states technically were not under British rule. The British ruled the whole of India minus the princely states. The princely states had a certain amount of independence, and there used to be a British resident there to sort of overlook. Now there's this Irish gentleman called Friedman. He later on went to Poland, so on. But he was basically an engineer. Earlier he was serving in Bangalore, and subsequently he got in touch with Appa Sahib Pant Pratinidhi, who headed the Aund Samsthan. Now what he said to him, and they became very thick friends, and Friedman practically turned into an Indian. He used to wear those Bhagwa robes and all that. So the British said, either you get rid of this, or we won't have any. We won't socially accept you. So he made friends with Appa Sahib, and they were together. So Appa Sahib had this Raja Ka Jail where there were, you know, murderers and others. So what Friedman said to him is, ki, why are you holding them in such prisons? Why are you being so brutal to them? So he said, ki, they are murderers. What else do you expect me to do with them? He said, no, give me 6 of them. I'll take them with me. I will reform them and prove to you that there is a human within a criminal also, even if the criminal happens to be a murderer. So let us tap him. But then Appa Sahib initially brushed off, saying, you know, this is all humbug, and I'm not very convinced. He said, give me 6. So he took the 6 of them and took them to a place called Atpadi in Sangli. Atpadi is a taluka place to the north of Sangli, and he established there what is called a prison colony. It was a very unique experiment. No prison colony exists anywhere in India even now. Atpadi. So what he did is, he said, my jail will have no boundary walls. They will live there. Nobody will guard these prisons. And he, along with 2 assistants of his, one of whom is Kazi Master and Audumbar Bhinge, they stayed with them in the prison. No guards, no fetters, no boundary walls. They were free to roam anywhere they like. The only thing is, evening they had to get back to their cells, voluntary, of their own volition, not under threat. So this experiment was very successful, and it was really very unique. After independence, Friedman left the place and he went back to his country, and they were now under the tutelage of Kazi Master. Kazi Master was the jailer, and there were the 6 of them. So what happened once is, this is very thought-provoking. The 6 of them, suddenly they fled one night in 1957. And lo and behold, within a few days they came back again. They said, ki, we wouldn't like to do this because you looked after us so well that we are coming back now and we'll stay here, we'll complete our sentences. And now when this so this was flashed in the local newspapers. There's this Marathi writer called Gadi Madgulkar. Some of you must have heard of him. So Gadi Madgulkar read it, and then he took it to V. Shantaram, saying, have you said this? Just read this news. You know, murder convicts flee, and on their own they get back after a couple of days. Isn't this very interesting? Then V. Shantaram said, I'll make a movie on this. And then he made a legendary movie called Do Aake Bara Haath. And later on, after independence, of course, the Indian government introduced a new policy wherein these murder convicts are allowed to live in the prison with their families, with their wives and their children. Now this is what that Atpadi colony looks like. So this is a murder convict, and that is his wife. So his wife lives there, his wife cooks for him. There is no boundary wall, there are no guards, they do not run away. Nobody has ever jumped the prison and escaped. This was a very famous movie. I don't know how many of these youngsters know this movie, but they may, you might have this is a very famous song there, sung by Lata
Mangeshkar.
Now let's move on to what the policies have been in Free India. The approach has now changed in toto. We do not follow the punitive policy, and now jails are called correctional institutions. So my designation is also changed. I am not the IG prisons now. I am the IG correctional services. Now the thrust area is vocational training to the prisoners, so that once they are released, they can work and feed themselves. Plus, we have a tremendous focus on maintaining mental health, inculcating a positive attitude, and release him a changed man. Now look at the slides that follow, very interesting ones. Okay, next. Now, so the food, that there is a certain scale now. They are given good food that would sustain them. So these are the kitchens in the jails. Next one. Now telemedicine, we have also introduced the concept of telemedicine. So through video conferencing, the jail inmate can speak with the doctor. Next one. Now easy access to lawyers and relatives. So these are cubicles. Within is the prisoner, and behind the bars, his lawyer or his relative sits, and they communicate with each other. Next. We also have yoga, pranayam, sports, band, orchestra, dhoni, tasha, bhajan, kirtan, and we also have an FM radio within the prisons. So this is yoga going on in Yerawada jail. Next. This is the laughter club. Pranayam. Sports activity going on. Hello. Now this is, if you look to the extreme left, there is a dhol tasha patak which was introduced just a week ago. Punyites claim dhol tasha to be their very own, and now this particular dhol tasha pathak is likely to participate in the Ganesh Utsav procession this year. So they'll play the dhol tasha. So we have a band in the Kolhapur prison. Bhajan kirtan mandalis are there in, so they learn there. See, the point here is not that they knew it before they got inside. Once they come inside, we have teachers, we have volunteers who teach them, and this is how it goes on. Next, this is the FM radio. There's an FM radio within the prison to keep them entertained. Next slide. This is the orchestra. Gala bait. Video calling and coin box. Now these are some of the musical nights that are held in the prison. Next one. Palki celebration. Rakhi. Now these girls are from schools and colleges. They descend down on the jail and tie rakhis. Next. Pola celebration in jail. Now the walls all over, you will find paintings on these walls. All these paintings have been done by the inmates. Now this what happens is, you know, there are some situations in which when the ladies are arrested and got into the jail, they are carrying. It happens. I mean, so some of the deliveries have happened in prisons. Then there are some of the celebrities. The one to the left is Shankar Madhav Madhavan, and the other one is Farhan Akhtar. Next. Now this is very important. We also impart a lot of education in it. People wanting to pick up degrees, acquire degrees, we facilitate it. Now this is an examination going on in the jail. So you can appear at, so these examinations, IGNU and this is basically Nasik and Hyderabad. So there are certain universities that offer courses to jail inmates, and examinations are held. They are given books, they study, and many have picked up degrees. You can see there. So they get out armed with degrees. Next. These are literary classes for people who cannot read and write. These are our libraries. Next one. This is a balwadi. You know what happens is if a lady inmate has a child less than 6 years of age, then one cannot obviously separate the child and the mother. So the child stays with the mother, but these are anganwadis for the children there. These are our computer labs. Many people have now picked up the art. Yeah, this is Edelweiss Personal Excellence. Next one. Now many NGOs are very closely working with us, one of which is Tata Trust, then Azim Premji Philanthropic Initiative, and also Prayas. Prayas is with the Tata Institute of Social Sciences. They have been with us for a very long time. Next. So this is the Honorable Chief Minister of Maharashtra when the MOU was signed. Tata Trust is also enabling us manufacture sanitary napkins in the jail. So in Nagpur, sanitary napkins are not only manufactured, some of which are now, we are planning to sell them now because they are very cheap. So ladies from villages who cannot afford, they can pick it up from them. Next. Put again. Now we have something called the Maharashtra Prison Industries. All these industries have been formed under a government order. Now the object of these industries is to impart skills so that he is gainfully employed when he comes out, and profit is not the motive. It is very clear. We do not run these industries to make profits. That we do make profits to the tune of 25 crore every year is beside the issue. Next. Now I'll tell you what. Now there is a factory manufacturing LED bulbs in Amravati. Now the next one is very interesting. If you go to Mahalakshmi Temple, Kolhapur, you'll be given laddus there. You know, a couple of laddus you'll be given there. All these laddus are manufactured by prisoners in the Kolhapur Kadamba jail, and I visited personally. It's very hygienic, and we make it a point to drain out all the oil from the bundis. So when you break those laddus, you won't get too much oil on your fingers. So we are also taking care of health of the consumers. They're not only tasty but hygienic and with very little oil. Next. Now Maharashtra textile industries. Here we do a lot of things. Our emphasis here is on handloom and cotton. So we'll come in detail to that. Kanpati idols are also made. There is a huge carpentry section in many of the industries. There is car washing facility at many industries. Mumbai madhe kuthe ahe ka? Thane. So if anybody wants to get his car washed, it will be washed at a pittance. You know, you have to just pay 177 rupees, and he'll do it much better than what the commercial guy does. That is an assurance from my side. Next. Rakhi making. Lady inmates make rakhis there. Plus weaving. Spinning, weaving, move on. Now, fantastic Kolhapuri chappals and leather shoes are manufactured in Yerawada jail. And I assure you, they are absolutely very good, very tough, very durable, very comfortable. We also have a smithy section. Now, this is the foundry section within the jail. This is hand cone making and winding. This is textile stuff. Beaming by sectional warping. Next. Maage. Carpet making. We make fantastic cotton carpets. The life of the carpet is 15 years. We are sure. Nothing will happen. Of course, it would get dirty. But it won't get damaged or it won't tear. We also have a dyeing section there. This is charkha. Now this is very interesting. So, you know, we make state of the art Paithani saris in our jails, and once again the assurance is, since we control the raw material, these are all handmade, so these are these are the best Paitani sarees, better than what you get in Paitan assurance from my side, plus reasonable rates. So those who want to buy Paitanis for their wives can surely pick it up. Boys, if you want Paitanis for girlfriends, but I believe girlfriends won't wear Paitanis. They won't wear, I suppose.
Now this is the power loom section where you manufacture cloth. Next, Smithy again. So these are some of the products that, these are all jail products there. Pude. Carpentry, we make fantastic teak wood furniture because our systems are very clear. We buy it from the forest department and make it there. So once again, quality control is ensured. Assured quality control. These are some of the products. Very ironically, let me tell you, I was just taking a stroll. You know, somebody had made a fantastic, chair for a high court judge. Official chair, of course. So he said, this is the chair who would be sitting in at the high court and convicting people like us from there. This is the founder. Now we have a tie with Gadge Patil Industries in Kolhapur. And this is the foundry section. Now, jail bakery products are fantastic. The moment we bring it to our stores, the consumer just picks it up. And a couple of hours, if you go there late, you won't get it out of sale. Plus, we have paper factories next. Now, we have very good tailoring sections. We manufacture ready-made clothes. Next, leather section. Now these are the chappals that I was mentioning. Very durable, very comfortable, and not very expensive, since profit is not the motive. Now these are the carpets I was talking about. Very sturdy carpets. Pude. We manufacture very good bed sheets and towels. See, I'm not a salesman. I'm just telling you the truth. Pude. Now this is the Jail Industries showroom of Maharashtra. Pude. And then the actress was the brand ambassador. Pude. Now we also hold an exhibition in Mantralaya every year, which is generally inaugurated by the Honorable Chief Minister of Maharashtra. This is Kitiwala. Thank you. colorful. Now, this is the revenues, 23 crore last year. Pude. So, this is agriculture. You can go through this very quickly. Pude. Mushroom plant, this is goat farming, fishery, poultry, farming. Now, the last and the most serious part of the discussion now. Somebody, you know, I was trying to impress somebody by showing him all these things, and he went on to say, ki, but why are you doing all this? I mean, he said, fine, this is all very fine, but then he's a criminal, he's committed a crime, so he should be punished. I mean, why this correctional approach? And this must be the question some of you might also like to ponder over. So I'll give the reasons for that. Why is there a change in approach? Why are we being so human? See, to begin with, in a civilized society, we can't be barbarians, but I will not dwell on that. I'll tell you something else. Who decides who a criminal is? It isn't God who decides. It's a system. It's our criminal justice system which would award a sentence and say, you're a criminal, you face the sentence. Now, the criminal justice system comprises the police, the prosecutor, and the courts. Is this system infallible? See, there is this saying, this is my own saying, of course, I haven't borrowed it from someone else. See, this particular system goes by evidence. And I always say this, truth is known to God alone, we go by evidence. Now, have there been any instances wherein an innocent has been wrongly convicted? Though the cardinal principle followed by the criminal justice system is that even if you set free 1,000 criminals, not one innocent should be convicted. But does it really happen that way? I cannot say yes. And I'll give examples, concrete examples. In UK, with the advent of DNA fingerprinting, then what happened is UK developed very strong DNA databases. It's the best and the finest in the world. They not only compare DNA samples, they have also gone in for comparison of familial DNA samples. So there was one case in which they conclusively established that a person who served a death sentence for murder in a jail was wrongly convicted. In Canada, there is an association called the Association in Defense of Wrongly Convicted. So it is not that a person is always rightly convicted. This is one thing we have to bear in mind. Number two, and I'm being brutally honest here. If you visit the jails, particularly the jails in India, you'll find poor people in it. Sir, are only the poor criminals? Does a rich man not commit crime? But to face this criminal justice system, you have to engage lawyers, you have to spend money, so on and so forth. The poor man cannot afford it. And it is eventually he who lands there. The others can afford to face the wrath of the criminal system and maybe wriggle through it. So the criminal justice system is actually, these jails are actually full of very, very poor people. You hardly find a rich man in there. And finally, it has also come to notice that there is talent in everyone. See, in every human, in every criminal, there is a human. And in every human, there is talent in some form or the other. Most of the people who we have just seen doing what they did here, they learned it after getting into the jail. And more importantly, this is my take on the matter. See, conditions in prisons are adverse, let us accept it. And adversity tends to get the best out of a man. Talents have blossomed in prisons. People have become writers, people have become singers, people have become painters, people have picked up degrees. I know of a case in which he picked up a law degree and began practicing in the court. I'll give yet another example. There's a sub-inspector of mine who was arrested for custodial death, and he spent 3 years in prison. He wrote a fantastic novel. A Marathi movie was made on it. So the idea is also to tap the talent, the hidden talent, the latent talent in that individual, and give him adequate opportunity to express it. And finally, now this is something very selfish. When the criminal comes out, if we brutalize him in prison, if we ill-treat him, then he will come out a hardened criminal. And once again, he will be a burden on the society. He'll recidivate. And once he recidivates, he'll go through the same procedure again. We just don't want that to happen. Thank you so much for this invitation. And I hope this was something different and you liked it. Thank you once again. Is there a question and answer session? Please feel free to ask questions. Sir.
Sanjay Dutt, and whether he taught somebody how to make movies or acting, something like that.
Please don't go by. There's a movie made later on. I've not seen the movie.
I've not either.
But that was not the way he was treated there, number one. And he hardly did much.
Okay. He was relaxing.
No, he wasn't. See, loss of freedom to someone who's used to 5-star comforts can be very, it takes its toll. But now we are awaiting two more now. The process is almost done. One is Nirav and the other one is the
Malya,
the party man. So they might land up in Arthur Road any moment. Yeah, the process is almost done. They are all within the prison. Not every prison. I'll tell you. You're talking about the outlets, the retail outlets. They are okay. Your point is well taken. We'll give it publicity. No, it's not there. It may not. So now. But there are other places also. There's one in Nagpur, so on and so forth.
And the cells be
correct. No, we would prefer to, retain our identity.
Yes, that is good.
That is
perfectly acceptable.
So the point is well taken and, yeah.
Yeah, so I have two questions. One is, you have been obviously seeing a lot of bankers also visiting you for the last 4 years now.
Bankers?
Jail.
Arthur Road.
Arthur Road, I guess, yeah. So, are there different facilities for these economic offenders?
Technically not. No. See, the British had classified prisoners into various categories. Now, there is no classification at all. If you are a dangerous criminal, you will be put in a cell. But this cell is not solitary confinement technically. Because he can see the other inmate, but he won't be able to converse. Now, who is put in these cells? Typically, terrorists, narcotics offenders and some other dangerous criminals. The rest of them are put up in barracks. So no, there is no classification now.
Okay, and second is about, obviously you mentioned about Vijay Mallya and Nirav likely to be there. So what was the big issue that was made in the UK courts? I mean, when they started talking about the prison system, I mean, It's very barbaric, etc. Vis-a-vis what the world prison system is.
More than barbaric, Indian prisons are indeed overcrowded. So overcrowding is an issue, and but we are all raring to receive him.
Reprieve given that these prisons were built by British
Correct, correct. So yes, sir. They are the creation of the British.
Yeah, absolutely. They are created by the British, right?
Definitely, sir. Definitely, sir. Definitely, sir. That will do, sir. We keep a track of that also, sir. We do keep a track of that. Definitely, sir. Definitely, sir. Sir, we create a lot of good writers. Definitely, sir. We will take a note of that, sir. Yes, sir.
In fact, majority of our freedom fighters became writers, whether Nehru or Gandhi.
Nehruji wrote The Discovery of India. Yeah. Same, sir.
Hello, sir. Sir, here.
Yeah.
Sir, I have two questions. My first question is, are these prisoners paid?
They are paid.
Okay, sir. My second question is, you are also a human, like somebody is rapist or murderer. So do you think Isaraka, like they are manufacturing things or... I mean to say they have a very healthy environment there. So, koi rapist hai, murderer hai, usko is tarah ka environment dena. Do you think ye sahi hai?
So you're wanting the prison department to brutalize him? I'm asking
sir,
you a counter question.
Because somebody has lost his life because of him. So uske baad bhi kya usko is tarah ka environment dena sahi
rahega? I think you did not then listen carefully to the last portion that I... The arguments are advanced in the shift from...
But sir, किसी ने अपनी लाइफ खो दी है तो उसको तो वापस ही लाया जा सकता ना
देखो इफ यू पूरी दुनिया में द वर्ल्ड ओवर ये कंसेप्ट अभी दीज आर ऑल थिंग्स ऑफ द पास्ट वाई वी शुड बी ह्यूमेन नॉट ब्रूटल मैंने आई थिंक आई गिव मेनी आर्ग्यूमेंट्स एट द फैक्ट एंड वी पॉसिबली वी कैन हैव अ सेपरेट डिस्कशन ऑन दिस
ओके सर थैंक यू
Indian scenario, if we see, even if a person is taken to the police station, he is seen with a bad eye. So, if these prisoners manufacture something, get a degree, and they get out, and they look for a job, will there be employment for them? Will people trust them?
I think you raised a very pertinent question. There used to be issues in the past when people were very wary of employing them. Given their criminal past. But I'll tell you, some of the prisoners have picked up such skills that they are readily absorbed. Be it textile manufacturing, or we give the example of Ghadge Patil Industries. So there are some, but see, these issues are going to linger. I mean, these won't vanish overnight because the blot they carry even after they are set free. But then this, we have to the extent possible, tackle. But some of them do get good employments and most of them, as I mentioned now, they are all farmers. They go back and they do farming.
Thank you, sir.
Hello. Sir, while having such a strong technical background, how did you convince your parents to go for CSE?
I didn't convince my parents. My parents wanted me to do it. And let me tell you one more thing. I mean, I think I must dwell more on this. I was a fairly reluctant candidate because I really liked chemical engineering and I still remember, sir, a lot of chemical engineering. For some strange reason, I've forgotten very little. So I still remember all those expressions. Once they have to leave the prison, now if you recall, I mentioned a few NGOs such as Tata Trust, APPI, they keep track of these children, ensure that these children go to school. There are instances wherein both parents are in jail, but the child is outside. You can have a situation of this sort also. The father is in jail, so is the mother, and the child who could be 7, 8, 9 years old, the child is kept track of, and there are several government schemes also for that. But these NGOs have really done a yeoman's job in really keeping track and ensuring that to the best possible extent they get good education. It varies from case to case.
Sir, there was a book and there was also a movie known as Shawshank Redemption.
That is the one of the finest movies ever made.
Yeah. So over there, they spoke about from a different outlook. They said prisoners many times who have spent a lot of years in prison don't want to leave it. They want to spend their entire life there. And they even give an example of a man who, when he was released at 86, mm-hmm. he couldn't cope with the changed world.
World outside, yeah.
So is that even true for Indian prisoners today?
Like? See, Indian situation is not exactly identical with that. But I'll tell you what has happened is, see, I'll give examples. There are some rag pickers and you know people who come sir is my colleague Deepak Pandey. He is an alumnus of IIT Kanpur. He is also in the prisons department with me. He is in charge of these four prisons: Arthur Road, where he is expecting somebody soon, Thane and Bhaikala, so on and so forth. So yeah, please continue with the question. So what happens is there are some India is essentially a very poor country, and some rag pickers, people who pick, you know, try to steal pieces of scrap, they volunteer to go to jail in India, because do time ka meal is assured. It happens. It is a fact. They come there because they feel, number one, there's a place to sleep, and meals are assured. It is a fact.
Did you pick up this appointment yourself, or it is the routine transfer?
It's a part of the routine transfer, sir.
But you think, like, culturally, you...
So what happened, while I was serving as a regular police officer, we did have some interaction with the jail authorities. But after joining, this has come as a pleasant surprise, because, sir, there's so much to learn. So much to learn, so much to do.
So there are many prisoners in jails. Yes, sir. Yeah. Many prisoners in the jails whose cases never get taken up get listed in the judicial system for judge.
See, pendency
and they just keep on lingering in the jails. So what happens to those?
Pendency is indeed a very major issue. So the government set up some fast track courts. But then, yes, this is a major issue. See, our population is gone up and is going up. It has escalated, gone through the roof. Innumerable cases are pending in the courts. That is a fact.
Nobody comes to pick up their cases also.
See, once again, as I had said this, I'm repeating what I have just said. And once again, I'm saying it in front of the camera, because this is a fact which cannot be denied. The poor find it very difficult to face the criminal justice system, because it is expensive. A good lawyer charges a lot of money. If you go to the higher courts, it's very expensive to go through the process. So our jails are full of poor people from a state, Bihar, UP. They are all languishing. There have been instances wherein an inmate could not get bail because nobody is wanting to stand as a surety, or he cannot furnish a security of 10,000 rupees. So he continues there. And this is where the NGOs have been doing a lot of very good work, helping them getting sureties, helping them getting security, and enabling them. See, our thrust area is to decongest prisons. What has happened is that in India, 70% of the inmates are under trials. The ratio is exactly the other way around in Western countries, where most of the prisoners are convicts.
Isn't there a case of a person who studied law while he was in jail, and then he becomes a proponent for fighting the cases of poor persons who took a degree in law while he was in
That, sir, will have to be examined as to what his conduct has been after he was released. It will have to be seen, sir, whether he's done it actually, or whether he is now like a very regular money-minded lawyer.
No, because of these prison reforms, are there fewer number of jail breaks?
At party, there has been no jail break. This is there, but there have off and on been attempts to break jails. I won't deny that. But Deepak, there haven't been too many. What happens, sir, is more often we take them out for extramural activity and then somebody walks away. But a very, very daring jailbreak, the kind we see in movies. Sir, Papillon is a very good example. It's based on a real life story wherein he swam the ocean and finally fled.
Or Charles Sobras.
I'll tell you the reason for that. See, the police jail. See, the police is not liked the world over. Bobby's may be a bit better. That is because the role of a policeman is essentially deprivational in nature. He will arrest you. He'll put you in. He'll fine you. He won't give you anything. See, what he gives is so very, you know, so very subtle, so very. See, like for example, if a policeman says, "I have improved the security scenario," that's not very tangible. But if you see him there standing, "Arey, ye pakdega, license puchega, he'll question me," so on and so forth. The police is never very liked anywhere in the world. So we have to live with it. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.